first shell would be the top row or the top tree on the periodic table. The first shell here is 1s, so what we need is we need two electrons first. The first electron would be like hydrogen, have one electron, and then helium. Helium would fill this shell.
That's an orbital, right?
Yeah, this would be an orbital.
I have my notes that the orbitals are like an infinite number of orbitals.
Yeah.
There's only.
There are an infinite number of orbitals.
But there's not an infinite number of like elements?
There's not an infinite number of elements. The orbitals, you know, as we go higher and higher, you will fill more and more orbitals. But for helium, the 2s orbital is empty, the 2p orbital is empty. All the orbitals above this are empty, unless it's in an excited state. You know, so there are an infinite number of orbitals. We map out the orbital energies. This is an orbital energy bubble diagram. And so we try to pinpoint the orbital energies. If we pinpoint the orbital energies like this, what that means for the position of the electron, it's not so clear. We end up with a blurry picture of the electron like this. You know, this is a probability map. It shows electron cloud density. The greater the electron cloud density, the more probable that electron will be found in that position. So as we go out further and further, the probability drops way down. So this would be a representation of orbital. This would be the 1s orbital. 1s orbital would have this energy, and we visualize the electron occupying the space here. This is a lot different than orbits. With orbits, we can pinpoint the electron. The electrons can be in orbit. These two aren't at the same scale. 1s orbital is very small, so the 1s orbital would be like this big. There are multiple orbits here, but there's only one orbital here. And so that's the orbital here. Now, as we go up, we'll go all the way from n equals 1, 2, 3, 4, all the way to n equals infinity. N equals infinity, that's not infinitely far away, that's like right here. What happens is you'll get an infinite number of orbitals that just kind of compress together as we go up higher.
Is it staying the same 2s, 3p, and stuff like that? Just when it goes to infinity, it carries the same value as, I'd say, 2s or something. Or does it repeat itself?
It doesn't repeat, it just goes like that, 2s, 3s, 4s, all the way to infinity. It's going to look like this. If you start at 1s here, then there's a 2s, and a 2p, and then 3s, 4s, 5s, 6s, 7s. Pretty soon, they start to get closer and closer. Eventually, you'll hit n equals infinity. And so we go from n equals 1, n equals infinity, not that much energy. If we're thinking about the orbits, though, or the orbitals, you know, the 1s orbital is small. And then we go to the 2s orbital. 2s orbital would be like 4 times bigger than the 1s. The 3s orbital would be like 9 times bigger than the 1s. When we get to the n equals infinity, then it's infinitely far away. It would be infinitely huge. And so although the orbital's huge, the n equals infinity orbital's huge, its energy is not. Its energy is here. And so the orbitals, the size diverges. It just keeps growing bigger and bigger. But the energies converge and will converge at some point.
So that's basically the orbitals are exponentially getting smaller.
Well, the energies are...
The energy exponentially not growing?
Yeah, they're converging. The energies are going to converge here. Here. Whereas the size of the orbitals diverge. It's going to get bigger and bigger and bigger. For the elements, we aren't going to look at an infinite number of shells. We're going to look at a limited number of shells because the elements will have a finite number of electrons. first shell is going to cover the first two elements. Hydrogen puts one electron in the 1s orbital, and then helium puts a second electron in there, and so we fill the first shell here. In the second shell, we have the 2s and the 2p. There are two electrons for the 2s, so we go from helium to lithium to beryllium here. And then the 2p would start off boron, carbon, nitrogen, oxygen, fluorine, neon. So we filled that. And so it starts with lithium and ends with neon here. And neon would fill the second shell. What does the third shell consist of? Third shell is going to consist of a 3s. So this 3s, we're going to start at sodium. And then to fill 3p's, we'll need 6 electrons for the 3p orbitals, and we'll end up with argon. So we can fill up the third shell with argon. And then we go to the fourth shell. The fourth shell is going to start with 4s, but it's different from the previous two. And the fourth shell will go 4s and then 3d and then 4p. So 4s takes 2 electrons, and 3d is going to take a total of 10 electrons for 5 orbitals, and then the 4p will take a total of 6 electrons.
So we fill them up in that order.
Yeah.
And 3d.
Right. We fill it up in that order, 4s to 3d to 4p. So whatever. What would the fifth shell consist of? 5s, 4d, 5p. And so the fifth shell and the fourth shell are very similar in the subshells that they have, S, D, P. What about the sixth shell? 6s. Okay, this gets tricky here because there's not enough room. What we have to do is it goes 6s, 4f, but they didn't insert the 4f here because that would make this table very wide. And so what they did was they removed the 4f and dropped it down here. So it goes 6s, 4f, to 5d, to 6p. The seventh shell does the same. It goes 7s, down to the 5f, to the 6d, to the 7p, to be out here. All right, that's not as hard to remember if we had a periodic table. When we look at periodic tables, they'll show us what would be those particular orbitals. There are actually two variations of periodic tables that we look at. Let's consider so when we get to the sixth shell here, we go 6s. And so scandium with 55 electrons would be 6s1. Barium with 56 electrons would be 6s2. So we get up to 6s. Now from 56 we go to 57. So we go 6s2, and then we start filling up the 4f. So 57 would be 4f1, 58 would be 4f2, all the way out. How many f orbitals are there? There's 7. If there's 7, that means 14 electrons. So we're going to go all the way up to 4f14, which is at the end. And then once we get to 4f14, that's 70 electrons. The 71st electron goes into, this is 3d, 4d, 5d. So this goes into 5d, and then we go across there. And so this periodic table tells us that we have to insert this here. So 57 goes down here. That's because there's not enough room. Okay, same thing with 7. You can see that here. Okay, there's one more type of periodic table which I'll talk about later. This is it. And so the periodic table is based on these shells of orbitals. Thank you. from the periodic table, we can also get the electron configurations. So let's go to let's go to the fourth shell here. If you look at the fourth shell is going to start off with the 4s orbital. So here, with potassium, we've got 4s1, and then calcium, 4s2. So we filled out the 4s. And then we go to scandium, which would be 4s2, 3d1. Titanium, 4s2, 3d2. It just goes in that order. We start filling up the d. Except there are two exceptions you have to memorize, and that is chromium and chromium was one exception, and what was the other exception? Well, yeah, copper. Chromium, you expect 4s2, 3d4, but it comes out 4s1, 3d5. Why? Why? Yeah, 3d4 would be like having a pie with one slice taken out of it. Versus 3D5 would be like having the whole pie or single layer cake. So this is like a single layer cake. So what you do is rather than 3D4 have one slice of cake missing, we'll just fill it. So this is called the half fill. Copper is the same thing. If you notice, it should be 4s2, 3D9. But we can complete that by just promoting electrons. So we take an electron from the 4s and promote it. So just those two orbitals. Everything else is 4s2, 4s2, 4s2.
I'm having a hard time visualizing that.
The exception?
Yeah. You feel like sort of like a visual.
Well, here, chromium should be 4s2, 3D. The way I visualize it is like this. I visualize it like a half filled set of orbitals would be something like this. A half filled would be like a two layer cake. Okay, you're only half filling it, so the top layer is missing. There are five slices. This is not such a great time. So there are five slices of cake. And so when I look at this, would be D5. We have all five slices. So it's nice and symmetric like this. But what D4 is this. If we go to D4, that means we remove one slice. If we remove one slice, then there's going to be a big slice taken out of this. Something like that. And so it's lost its symmetry. It no longer has what we call spherical symmetry. And so it's not going to be as stable as that. And so what we can do is we can just take a slice out of the 4s. A half-filled 4s is spherical anyway, and then promote it to 3D. So if we do that, then we'll take an electron from the 4s so that we can complete this here, and then have the half-filled. Copper is the same way, but copper has the first layer that's filled. So copper is D9, so on the second layer, it has one slice missing on the second layer. And so it's lost that symmetry. But if it can get that slice from the s orbital, then it gains that symmetry. And so copper would be this. Normally, it should be 4s2, 3d9. There's one slice missing. If there's only one slice missing, then what we're going to do is we're going to take that from the 4s and promote it to the 3D, so we have a completely filled D subshell.
Why does it have to be filled with 3D?
Like fill filled shells and filled subshells.
Is it has more to lose or something?
Hmm? Yeah, except the 4S and the 3D are pretty close in energy. You know, there's not a big difference in the 4S and the 3D. And so, yeah, it's going to cost you a little bit. You need to fill the lower energy first, but this is the one of the two exceptions that you just memorized. Let me see if I have something to show you. Yeah, this is what they call ad hoc. You know what ad hoc means? A-D-H-O-C? Ad hoc means, what was the reason? The reason was it was observed. 4S1 3D10 was observed, so they had to come up with some kind of ad hoc explanation of what was happening there. This is the ad hoc explanation of what's happening. So... That's so it wasn't that they predicted this was going to happen. It was that they predicted the 4S2 3D9 was going to happen, but what was observed was a 4S1 3D10. And so they had to come up with some kind of reasonable understanding of that. And the reasonable understanding was this whole business we're talking about here. What are the advantages? Well, when you have, this is based on some physics. When you have like this thing, or you have this symmetry here, that is, there's not a piece of cakes, you know, you have a full cake there. You know, it has that symmetry, and there are advantages in physics. So taking advantage of the symmetry, the spherical shell, so there are advantages in that. Spherical symmetry. This is a big topic in science. In fact, there's math class that a lot of people take. It's called group theory. In group theory, all you do is you look at symmetry, you know, spherical symmetry, threefold symmetry, sixfold symmetry. You just look at symmetry, and then you do all the math. So it's pretty interesting stuff. It's not that complicated, but it's extremely powerful.
There's formulas, right?
No, I mean, there's formulas, but it's just like a secret code. Once you learn what the secret code is defined, then it's not that, you know. I mean, if you look at the map, if you look at the equations of group theory, then it looks intimidating.
Is that how they get like all those depictions on the magnetic field and stuff?
If you look at the equations of group theory, it looks intimidating, but it's not really that. This is that's linear algebra.
Did you take that class?
Yeah.
How would you rate it on a scale of 1 to 10?
That's probably the best math class I ever took. Group theory.
It's like a 10 out of 10 then.
For chemists. Group theory was
just
most
for
useful.
Just for chemists? What does it mean?
Chemists and physicists. Yeah, this is group theory deals with a lot of matrices. This is this kind of group theory type of stuff. It's pretty cool. Pretty interesting stuff.
Is it like its own math, or is it like a branch of?
No, it's like geometry. not, I, the group geometry was one of the worst math classes I took.
Oh my god, me.
It's geometry, geometry is proofs, I hated the proofs. But group theory was, yeah, group theory was one of the best. But even though group theory has lots of geometry in it, it's much better. Anyway, the reason is that you just, the reason you understand it is because the additional stability came from half-filled and filled D subshells. Half-filled and filled D subshells both have spherical symmetry, you know, versus partially filled D subshells won't have spherical symmetry, so it's not going to be as stable. You know, spherical symmetry, you can imagine, you know, this is what we get. If we overlay all the d orbitals, one on top of each other, all five of them, if we do that, then it's spherical symmetry. If we overlay all the p orbitals, one on top of each other, it's spherically symmetric. So I wasn't sure about this figure. This figure, I wasn't sure, to be honest, about this one. This could be either a single 1s orbital or it could be a filled shell. A filled shell will be spherically symmetric like this. And so when you look at the electron cloud distribution, it'll be similar to that.
So where's the nucleus in there?
Yeah, there's a nucleus right here in the center. It's a nucleus. And each dot represents the probability of finding electrons. This is like the bird map. Each dot represents the position of an electron in some instance. Alright, so what we're going to do is we're going to get the electron configuration based off the periodic table. And so let's take a look at the two types of periodic tables and then figure out how we can derive the electron configuration from those. Now this one has hydrogen up over there, but it doesn't matter. Let's get the electron configuration for technetium, TC, element number 43. One thing we could do is, what shell is that to? Okay, so that's the first shell, second, third, fourth. This would be in the fifth shell. So for fifth shell, I'm not going to have you draw an orbital energy level diagram like this. We're just going to do the electron configuration. So if we do the electron configuration for technetium, TC, what we're going to do is, since a lot of electrons, 43 electrons, we're going to go back and look at the last shell that was filled. The last shell that was filled is krypton. So this will be the nearest noble gas. Krypton has 36 electrons. So krypton fills up the fourth shell. Now we're in the fifth shell. So let's go ahead and start the fifth shell here. So, not the fourth shell. Sorry, krypton fills what shell? Oh, sorry. No. I got mixed up. Krypton actually fills the fourth shell. Yeah, it starts with forest too. Sorry. So we fill up the fourth shell. Now we're on the fifth shell. So the fifth shell is going to start with what? 5s2. So 5s1 is like rubidium, 5s2 silicon. So over here, krypton, 5s2. Okay, and then go across. This is 38, 39 is here. Yttrium. So that would be 5s2. This is 3D here, so this would be 40. 41, 42, 43, 44, 45. 5s2, 45. Now, if you look at that 4D, the 4D is already half filled, so we don't have to do any weird stuff, right, to make it half filled. You know, we'd like it half filled. If we only have to promote one electron, we'll do it. In this case, we don't have to promote any electron. It's already half filled. So that would be be technetium. Let's try another one. Let's try neodymium, element number 60, neodymium, down there. What shell is neodymium in? Fourth shell, 5s,
6s.
Yeah, it's going to be in the sixth shell.
6s.
So if we take a look at it, the sixth shell starts off with scandium. Scandium has how many electrons? Let's see the resolution on this, of course, sorry. Scandium has 55 electrons here. So this is 6s1. Barium has 56 electron. So 6s1, 6s2. So neodymium would be, actually, that's the sixth shell. What fills up the fifth shell? Xe? So let's go back. Yeah, Xe would fill up the fifth shell. So Xe is xenon. So this is going to be xenon. 6s2. Okay, so we go here. Now we got to look at the periodic table carefully. This is barium element number 56. Where's 57? 57 is not lutetium, because lutetium, if you look at the number here, it's 71. And so we got to go from 56 to 57. Where's 57? Lanthanum, down here. And so it goes 6s1, 6s2, to 4. This is 4F1. 4F2, 4F3, 4F4.
Hey, question. This periodic table, you have the class one.
Yeah.
LA, whatever that element is.
Right. There are two periodic tables. Did you know that?
Nope.
Two versions of the periodic table. This is one version. One version is this. 56. Is barium, 57 is lanthanum, and lanthanum is down here in the 4F. Lutetium's up here. What's the other variation of the periodic table? No.
Lutetium's all the way at the head.
No, unfortunately, it didn't replace it. You know what would be better if they just had one version of the periodic table rather than two?
Which one is the correct one? More correct.
Whichever one you have is the most correct one. So whichever one you have, just go by that. If you look at our periodic table in class, our periodic table in class is not the one you just saw. The periodic table in class looks like this. So let's go here. We're in the sixth shell, right? And so for the sixth shell, we start off with 6s1, 6s2. That takes us to barium, which is element number 56. But now where is 57?
Right next to it.
But right next to it is not 4F. Right next to it is, well, this is 3D, this is 4D, this would be 5D. So we go 5D1 with 57. And so if we use the other periodic table for neodymium, we get xenon. 6S2, that's the same. But what's different is we go 5D1. 5D1 takes us to the 57th electron. Well, where's 58? It's down here. And so now it goes 4F1, 4F2, 4F3. Do you see that? And so we get a totally different electron configuration. From the first periodic table we use, we get xenon, 6s2, 4f4. From the second periodic table we use, we get xenon, 6s2, 5d1, 4f3. So which one is it?
The bottom.
It turns out it's actually the bottom one, the one from the data.
I think because it's more dependent.
It's the bottom one, but it also depends on which periodic table you get. So the bottom one, they try to make it to match the experimental data. And the 4F and the 6D are very close in energy, so there is some weird stuff that happens there. But when look at Wikipedia, what does Wikipedia have? When we look at Wikipedia for neodymium, Wikipedia has xenon 6s2 4f 4, and so they're using the top one.
Oh, yes.
And so it depends on what book you look at as well, as to which one it's going to be. And so
is that normal? Why would they flip the s and the s?
They do that to show the they have two orders. They have the filling order, which is this, and then they have the taking order, the removing order. And so the electrons that are going to be lost first are the 6s. They're the furthest away from the nucleus, followed by the 4f. So this is the ionization order. It doesn't matter which one is right. But when we derive these, we do by the filling order. All right, so we just ended up with two. So my feeling, my opinion about this is, just do it based on whatever periodic table you have. And just be aware that there are two different versions of the periodic table. All right, let's take a break.